Good evening, everyone. If you have a a line item you'd like to speak on, please fill out a speaker slip. Looks like this. It's in the back. Oh, sorry. I'm really tall. I'm just really tall. There. Can you hear me now? Beautiful. Can you hear me back there? Yeah. Can you hear me now? All right. Roll call, please.
Chair Rafael Avendano.
Present.
Vice Chair Mary Martinez.
Present.
Councilmember Laura Kaplan.
Up here.
Councilmember Linda Lopez.
Present.
Councilmember Beatrice Cerillo. Councilmember Dale Miller.
Here.
Councilmember Everardo Rodriguez.
Here.
Councilmember Esperanza Vasquez. Youth Member Diane Zermeno.
Here.
And then alternate Youth Member Emily Cordova.
Here.
We're gonna move to our second item for the day, public comment. Anyone may speak up to 2 minutes on any topic not on the agenda. Please fill out a speaker slip. The council may not discuss or take action on items not on the agenda. We have a speaker slip here. Wanna announce speaker?
Oh, okay, sir. Heather? Heather Peters from San Mateo County Housing. Okay, and you have 2 minutes, Heather.
Good evening. I've met most of you before in my work with the San Mateo County Department of Housing. I just wanted to stop by tonight to give you a quick update on the Middlefield Junction redevelopment project for 2500, 2600, 2700 Middlefield Junction, which would include this parcel here. As you know, we have a joint agreement with Redwood City to each provide $100,000 worth of funds to hire a master planner. And I'm happy to say that we just issued the RFP for a master planner, request for proposals. It's available on the Department of Housing website. If you have anybody you would like to pass that on to, please let them know. The bids are due August 1st, and we hope to have a planner hired by September. And once that planner gets on the ground, we'll be back to you and engaging in very, very robust public outreach to get the best thinking in the community on what this can be for the future.
Thank you. All right. We're gonna move on to line item number 3. Approval of minutes. Minutes from council meetings on April 28, 2016 and May 26, 2016. There is copies in the back, if you'd like to see them, I believe. Thank you.
I think there was a confusion.
I only have May, I mean April. Do you have your May?
Do you have May?
Oh, we have April, which is off. Maybe,
Okay.
Does anyone have
it? Can we leave that pending?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And approve it next time?
Mm-hmm. All right.
Yeah. Done. So it appears. This is working. It appears we only have copies from the April 28 meeting. So I think we'll move forward with approving those, and we'll have to pass the approval of May 26th meetings to the next meeting, unfortunately.
No. We're just taking our time here reviewing. Thank you.
I think the public has it.
Through the chair, I motion that we approve the minutes of April 28th.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
Any discussion? All right. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? All right. Motion carries. Thank you. We're going to move on to presentation line item number 4. Presentation on the Dumbarton Transportation Corridor Study. Today we have Melissa Reggiardo. I hope I said that right, from SamTrans.
That's good.
All right.
Good. Good evening. My name is Melissa Reggiardo. I'm the project manager for the Dumbarton Transportation Corridor Study. I'll be giving you an update on the Dumbarton Corridor Study, which kicked off in late February. I know some folks were asking for copies of our presentation. I just wanted to mention that it is on our website. But perhaps it's also maybe easy if there's a number of people, we can take down your name and I can send you the electronic version. You know, come to me after my presentation and I can give you my card. But we can provide that. All right. So this is an aerial photograph of the Dumbarton Corridor, which includes both the highway bridge and also the rail bridge located to the south. The highway bridge, or Highway 84 as we know it, is a state highway, and of course then it's managed by Caltrans. SamTrans is the owner of the rail bridge. So as you know, the Dumbarton Corridor is a very busy one, and it has nearly 77,000 daily trips. And so this exceeds 2006 traffic levels by about 5%. The Dumbarton Corridor is one of the primary thoroughfares for commuters who live in Southern Alameda County and who work in San Mateo and Santa Clara counties. Interestingly, 79% of weekday trips in the morning peak are headed west, and only 21% are headed east, and so we see a reverse of this pattern in the evening. Buses account for about 5 to 6% of peak period use, and 70% of bus ridership on the bridge is attributable to private shuttles. We generally see the highest use from Fremont, Palo Alto, Newark, Menlo Park, Union City, and Redwood City, with major travel markets seen between Fremont and Palo Alto, and also between Palo Alto and Ardenwood. So if we were to summarize the problem, I think we could say that there's a jobs housing imbalance between the East Bay and the Peninsula, and it's been recently made worse by major employment growth in both San Mateo and Santa Clara counties. Also, there are large gaps in the South Bay transportation network, and so the rail lines in South Bay and the East Bay are not connected. And while the highways are connected across the bay, there are still generally few options when it comes to trans-bay travel. And so bridges like Dumbarton and also San Mateo become heavily congested in the peak hours, and travel times are pretty unpredictable. So to help back this up, this map shows existing population in the study area. We can see that the East Bay generally has higher density, though we see high density pockets located in East Palo Alto and on the peninsula. And we also see some high-density pockets in Union City. While peninsula population is expected to increase by about 25% by 2040, East Bay population, by percentage, is expected to increase slightly more, around 28%. This is a map, a similar map, that shows existing employment in the study area. We see some high-density pockets in Fremont, Palo Alto, and Redwood City, but we also see a lot of other employment hotspots distributed along the peninsula especially. And so while East Bay jobs are expected to increase by about 24% by 2040, peninsula jobs are expected to increase by percentage slightly more at 28%. So to some extent, it seems like the trends we see today will continue into the future. So to give a little background about the Dumbarton Corridor and previous studies, it's safe to say that the Dumbarton Corridor has been studied many times before. The last work was completed in 2011, and this was an alternative study. The study looked at both rail and bus options, and it carried forward three different rail alternatives in addition to a no-build, which is like an existing conditions scenario, and a transportation systems management alternative, which is a bus scenario. And it did this into an environmental impact report. However, the environmental impact report was put on hold in 2014 due to very high project costs and a lack of funding. But since that point, I think it's safe to say that the Bay Area has experienced some job growth, increased congestion, and of course with that, greater jobs, housing imbalances. And so the Dumbarton Corridor now is being revisited as a way to increase multimodal mobility across the Bay, given these recent demographic changes. So SamTrans, as the owner of the Dumbarton Rail Bridge, is managing the Dumbarton Transportation Corridor study. But SamTrans is working with several key important partners. We're working with the transportation authorities on each side of the bay. So that includes the San Mateo County Transportation Authority, as well as the Alameda County Transportation Commission. We're also partnering with AC Transit, who currently operates the Dumbarton Express services across the highway bridge, as well as the U line. And then we're working with Facebook, who's providing our funding support, as well as a very interesting private sector perspective. We've identified a study schedule of about 15 months. And of course, you can see it here, but we identify the study area with the major cities, including on the peninsula, Redwood City. Part of the right-of-way goes through the county. Menlo Park, East Palo Alto, Palo Alto, and of course in the East Bay, we're focusing on Newark, Fremont, and Union City.
That's almost illegible.
Yeah, no, I know it's a little distorted. I'm happy to provide you a copy after this.
Maybe have the opportunity to look at it now.
Sure.
Okay, great.
Yeah, actually, you can see it better from here. And so what you're looking at, I'll add a little more detail. The large square is our tier one cities, which is the cities that I just listed off. Sure. And then we're also, because they're really important to our travel market analysis as part of the study, we're looking at, you know, Mountain View, Sunnyvale, Santa Clara in the South Bay, and then of course the Tri-Valley cities in the East Bay.
Can you show us something else?
Sure.
Thank you.
Yeah, no problem. Okay, so we've got Menlo Park's right here, just to give you some context. We've got Newark, and so the highway bridge is right here. The rail bridge is slightly to the south. And of course, these are the other, you know, Mountain View, Sunnyvale, Santa Clara, and then the Tri-Valley cities up here. So these are important for our travel market analysis, but really the focus of the corridor is in here. Okay, so unlike previous studies, this study is going to examine improvements to the rail bridge as well as the highway bridge and the arterials on each side of the bay. So arguably, this study, as opposed to the previous studies, will be a little bit more comprehensive. Also, the study is going to focus on both short-term and long-term improvements and the phasing of these improvements over time. So for the purposes of this study, short-term will be considered improvements that can be implemented by or around 2020, while long-term improvements are those that can be implemented by or around 2030. So SamTrans has several goals for the study. Some are listed here. Of course, we want to study operational and capital improvements that enhance mobility. We want to work with regional partners to expedite improvements both in the short and the long term. And we want to assess how the rail bridge can potentially be used to make use of the valuable asset. So So SamTrans is currently finalizing our performance metrics to evaluate our proposed alternatives. The following metrics are some that are being proposed. They're proposed to be weighted the same. This is not an exhaustive list. We're still going through this process, but we've identified these as being really important. So looking at average peak period travel times, person throughput, cost per user, and net capital cost. We'd like to look at risk, and so that includes considering safety, environmental and financial issues. And then, of course, we want to pay some special attention to disproportionate burdens and disparate impacts on local communities to ensure that anything we propose doesn't have very significant burdens on specific communities. Sure, and actually those terms come from Title VI analyses, which occur when transit agencies like SamTrans either add, modify, or take away service. And so basically the point is to look at equity and to make sure that anything we propose isn't going to benefit one community while really adversely impacting another. That's the intent. Sure, so it's, you know, when we're looking at highway improvements and also any sort of transit improvements, how many people can it carry? Yeah. Like, it's sort of like efficiency.
I'm going to interject very quickly. I know these are all good questions. There'll be time for questions after the presentation is finished with the completion of a speaker form, so to make sure we stay on task and on agenda. Sorry.
So in the initial phase of the study, we're looking at a very broad array of alternatives, even some that might seem a little bit unlikely. So as part of this effort, the study is going to examine a wide variety of short and long-term alternatives on the highway bridge. They're listed here. Short-term improvements primarily include Dumbarton Express enhancements and or new routes, and other transit priority improvements, so things that can really speed up current bus service. Long-term improvements can include bus lanes, added general purpose lanes, maybe some auxiliary lanes, along with other types of managed lanes improvements, which could include HOV lanes, maybe an HOV3, or potentially tolled or express lanes. In terms of phasing, an example of short to long-term improvements could be express improvements in the short term, Dumbarton Express improvements, and then express or tolled lanes on the bridge in the long term. So the study will also examine a wide variety of short and long-term alternatives on the Dumbarton right-of-way, so from Redwood City to East Palo Alto, as well as the rail bridge. There are generally no short-term alternatives involving the rail bridge because any alternative on the rail bridge would require bridge rehab. There is a short-term option to construct a bike ped trail on the right-of-way from Redwood City to East Palo Alto. And of course, we're going to look at a very wide variety of modal alternatives, both on the right-of-way and the rail bridge. This includes bus rapid transit, light rapid transit, commuter trains like Caltrain. We're going to look at some more unique options like personal rapid transit, group rapid transit. We even have some that actually wouldn't operate on the rail bridge, but we feel like it's important to look at them. This includes the Hyperloop technology that's not quite proven yet, but it's a really interesting idea. Ferry service, as well as a gondola or an aerial tramway, and also a monorail or a people mover. An example of phasing could potentially be a bike trail on the right-of-way from Redwood City to East Palo Alto in the short term, and then that could be followed by rail on the right-of-way and on the rail bridge in the long term. And of course, that's just an example. In terms of next steps, our next step are to take these very broad list of alternatives and combine them, package them, and take them through an initial screening process. And we'll do this using our evaluation metrics. Only a small number of alternatives will be carried forward and developed further through conceptual engineering activities, ridership modeling, and also financial analysis. The alternatives will be taken through a comparative analysis, and then after this point, once we're able to identify preferred alternatives, both in the short and the long term, we'll identify financing plans, financial plans, and of course, the proposed phasing of the alternatives over time. It's important to note that our evaluation will include the investigation of public-private partnership opportunities. So we're reaching out to stakeholders and the public at three major study milestones. The meetings we held in May were the first milestone. We'll be reaching out again in September, and we'll be discussing the initial alternative screening at this point in time, and we'll be talking about the alternatives that we've selected to be carried forward for further analysis. Of course, we'll also be reaching out around April 2017 towards the end of the study. This is a graphic, a flow chart that shows the various steps of the project development process. It highlights when we'll be engaging the public and our stakeholders. So the first blue box, of course, represents what we did in May. The second will be what we do in September. There are many ways that you can comment on this study. I've listed them here. We have our website up. Our presentation materials from our May meetings, which are mostly similar to this, are posted. Also, you can feel free to email me comments. You can also call me. You can send me a letter. I accept comments throughout the study at any time. Happy to hear what you have to say.
All right. Thank you.
And that's time for comments and questions.
Yeah. So we're going to start with questions from council members, and then we're going to go to public comment. Questions from council members on the report today from Dunbar.
One quick suggestion, if you can leave the information that you had in the previous slide,
this is a good
so
time
that people
to
can
fill out a speaker
write
slide.
Down the information of where, the website, et cetera. That would be
sure.
great.
Sure. Yeah, I think I can save it on your desktop, and you can just keep it up, even after I go.
Okay, I have a couple of questions. Just as a kind of a side issue, the pedestrian path was talked about in a presentation to this council several months back by Facebook, and they sort of made it sound as though it was moving forward and happening. And I just was curious if there is a time frame for that or if there's any decision that's been made on that.
Yeah, that's a great question. No decision has been made. Though they're moving ahead with the design plans and the environmental process for the bike ped path, it's actually being investigated as part of our study. So it's a little bit backwards, but our study will inform that process.
And then a second question, thank you.
Sure.
I couldn't quite see on the map, it looked like a corner of that block was, I mean, I know you're saying that it's going to look at the entire area, but I also know that there are areas around that SamTrans doesn't necessarily control. I'm thinking specifically of feeders such as Marsh Road, which is so heavily impacted right now that sometimes it takes an hour just to go a mile. And obviously that's feeding onto the bridge, so, and there's been no talk or effort to change that in any way. So I don't know if this study would be broad enough to take a look at that and involve some of the kind of participants in that?
Yes, so the study is broad enough to look at that. And so, you know, it's difficult to look at the highway bridge in isolation without looking at the approaches on each side. So on the peninsula, you're right, it's Marsh Road, it's Willow, it's University. And so we're taking a look at highway configurations as well as approach improvements. And so, you know, this is a feasibility study, so anything we put forth would, of course, have to be investigated again. It would have to go through the environmental process, and, of course, other entities would have to get involved. But, yeah, we're absolutely looking at that. In some ways, the approach improvements might be more important than what we actually do on the bridge.
So has there been any discussion about the possible station that interfaces with the bullet train that's going to be the future?
Potentially, that type of discussion is going to be really important for the next phase of our study. So after we're able to screen down some of these alternatives and we start to sort of pick out the best alternatives to proceed forward with, yeah, that's when we're going to be discussing all sorts of station placement issues as the alternatives will be going through some conceptual engineering analysis.
Okay, you also listed personal rapid transit. Could you explain that?
Sure. You know, it's funny. It doesn't exist in that many places, but there is a system at Heathrow, at the airport, if you've been there. I believe there's also a very small system working in West Virginia on a university campus, I believe. So not a really well-known transit option, but basically you hop in a little capsule and it's sort of, you need a pretty complex network for it to work pretty well. But, you know, it's sort of under this very broad array of alternatives that we wanted to look at as part of the study. May not be completely appropriate for this corridor. I don't suspect that it is, but we just wanted to make sure that we were doing what we needed to do, do our due diligence and look at everything, at least initially.
Where would you expect the funding to come primarily for the study and then to proceed with the project?
So Facebook has funded this study. We are uncertain about where the funding would come from for any improvements that we recommend. Certainly, that's a big component of this analysis once we get a little bit farther, is to identify financing plans, funding plans, potential public-private partnerships. We'd love to get some private money, of course, right? Because funding is always one of the biggest challenges of these types of transportation improvement projects.
Yeah, and I asked this question because from previous attempts to revive, you know, a version of this plan, I understand that some of the cities in the East Bay were reluctant to provide funding for this project. And essentially, the last time that this project was trying to come alive, that was pretty much what killed it.
Right, yeah, and that's why it was put on hold, was just a lack of public funding available for the project.
Yeah. Can you explain the study's inclusion of local constituents within the policy and framework development for from youth to elderly?
Sure. So our goal is to reach out both to stakeholders and also the public. So I think you're asking about our public meetings at study milestones?
Yeah, just the model of design that you're going to have everyone from all different scopes involved in the creation of what you're going to come up with for the plan.
So the way we're incorporating the public and any member of the public, whether it's youth or seniors, is that, you know, anyone with interest in the study can come out to our public meetings and of course provide me comments at any time. And all of those comments essentially get incorporated into our process to the extent that we are able. Does that sort of get to your question?
Yeah, but is there a position in place for each like demographic age group of person to be a part of the, as a stakeholder decision maker within the process movement?
No, we didn't really separate out specific demographic groups, just targeting everyone generally. Of course, you know, we try to target people that live in the area, whoever they are, through, you know, targeted meeting invites through our Facebook page, as well as, that's actually a really good question for our public affairs folks who actually disseminate information about our meetings. But yeah, we're trying to make sure that people who live in the adjacent area know about our meetings so they're able to come out. And we hold them in the evenings in an effort to make it easier for members of the public to come out and ask questions and provide comments.
Yeah, I just see this as a golden opportunity for a young person or an older person to be involved in the creation of something really special with the people that are on the board.
Absolutely.
Can you please remind me, please, what's going to happen in September?
Sure.
You had some calendar. The position of the screen was not really a good position, so I missed
all of that
piece. Sure,
and I'm probably also in the way.
Yeah.
So the main point here is that we reached out to our stakeholders and members of the public in May, which we considered to be our first study milestone. And so at that point, I presented things very similar to what I presented to you tonight, a lot of information about our process, a lot of information about our initial alternatives. In September, which we see to be the next study milestone, we're planning to reach out to our stakeholders and the public again. And this time we'll be talking about our initial alternative screening process and what alternatives rose to the top in our analysis. So what we're proposing to carry forward for further analysis.
Okay, thank you. I have some additional questions,
sure.
Melissa. So do I understand correctly, Facebook is helping with the funding
for the study.
And they've already given you a plan for what?
No, they haven't provided a plan, but they are a study partner. So they're working with us throughout the study.
Okay. So there were conversations that council had with Facebook. I don't even remember. Was it last year? It may have been last year. Specifically around bike lanes, which is a form of transportation.
Mm-hmm.
So is that going to be part of the big picture? Because we need to also get our discussion points in there. Council has held many community meetings where that was one of the topics, one of the issues. So there's already a lot of opinion and discussion on what might work for North Fair Oaks, just mm-hmm. specifically on that piece. So I just putting that out there so you remember to pick that up when you get to that point.
Sure. Okay. And actually, I think we're there. So if you have specific comments about that, I'd love to get them tonight. But yes, our study does address bike ped, both on the right-of-way and potentially on the rail bridge, but also as an alternative to that, I think we do, at a very high level, have to look at bike lanes that would be outside of the right-of-way.
Well, there was a nonprofit group called, was it Silicon Valley?
Bicycle Coalition?
Yes. So they were very instrumental in bringing a lot of information to North Fair Oaks and during all of those community study sessions. So if they're not involved in your process, I highly recommend that they be invited to be part of the process.
And I can definitely reach out to them. I have a few people that I've worked with previously.
And just my last question, thank you very much for the presentation. Do you have hard copies of your PowerPoint?
I didn't bring hard copies tonight, but it's on our website.
Okay.
So I can also give you my card. I can email you an electronic version.
Okay. All right. Thank you very much.
Sure.
Any other questions from the council?
I do. So I know you were talking about how there was like a job and housing imbalance between the East Bay and the Peninsula. So I was just wondering if at the moment, if people on the project know to like what extent that this project would help alleviate the issue?
That's a great question. So that's something that we want to get at in our more detailed analysis. So after we're able to sort of stake this very large list of alternatives, both on the highway bridge and the rail bridge, and once we identify the ones that are worth evaluating a little bit more, we're going to be doing some ridership modeling. And I should note that the model is not the end-all be-all, right? It is only a prediction. But the whole purpose is to try to gauge the benefits that each transit or highway improvement would provide. And having said that, it's very difficult to model some alternatives over others. So some of them might be modeled off model. But the point is we're trying to really look at how much benefit it can provide to the extent that we can.
Thank you.
Yeah.
All right. Any other questions, council? All right, we're going to move on to public comment. You want to?
Yeah, sure.
Henry Riggs wants to speak about
thank you, sir.
The plan.
Hi, Henry. You have 2 minutes. Enjoy your time. Yeah, you just go up there and you use the microphone.
Go to the podium. You have 2 minutes. And if you could give us your name, please, and where you live.
Thank you.
My pleasure, and thank you for holding this meeting. I'm Henry Riggs from Menlo Park. And I have a relatively short question for SamTrans. And that is, given that the roughly 10-year-ago project to potentially send Caltrain cars over the Dumbarton Bridge one way in the morning and then back in the afternoon, that met a great deal of neighborhood opposition, and it also required the complete rebuild of the bridge corridor, essentially making the supposed asset into nothing but the right-of-way. To what degree will our study investigate an alternative that more largely uses the existing infrastructure, specifically by using very much lighter equipment? Thank you.
Yeah, so we're gonna go, we're gonna have the responses after, if that's all right. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you. John Waddell? Did I pronounce that correctly?
That's outstanding. Thanks.
All right.
I'm going to just hold
tell
this
us where you live, please,
it's
John.
It's a little bit low. John Waddell, Menlo Park. I'm glad that we're having another study. I am confident this has been studied quite a lot, but I believe the brief history is in the 1960s, five guys on the Board of Supervisors said, Caltrain is adequate. You can just have some tracks. People walk on, they go to work. You don't need infrastructure. You don't need level boarding. You don't need any of that stuff. It's totally adequate. But after Prop 13 passed in the 70s, people are kind of stuck wherever they are. So people aren't moving to live in places that are close to their work. Also, it's very expensive to live places. So we definitely need to figure out how can we reimagine getting some kind of rail system over there. If we had BART running from Millbrae down to, well, actually in 2000, they talked about running BART from Millbrae down to Menlo Park, and it got killed at the Board of Supervisors. So if we had that running to Fremont, that would clearly get rid of a lot of cars. I think the idea of shutting down lanes and putting in bus lanes and things like that is just going to take away from traffic. And I guess the other thing I wanted to say is when I'm usually on a bike or on Caltrain, but whenever I do try to get on a car to go on the freeway, I'm sitting backed up getting onto 101 because there's a bunch of cars that are trying to get over the bridge. And once you get past the cars that are on line to go across the bridge, you can get on the freeway. And then you get stuck behind the cars that are going to across San Mateo Bridge. So if we basically put in a HOV lane on 101, I think that would actually allow an incredible amount of traffic and to get through, and maybe we would have less people stuck that are carpooling. Thank you.
All right, thank you.
Thank you. Okay, Mary Coady. I'm sorry, say that again? Or when you get up there, tell us your name.
My name is Mary Coady.
Okay.
Hi, Mary.
I live in the unincorporated part of Menlo Park. From what I can see, the line runs very close to North Fair Oaks, although I have to say the signage and the charts were not clear, and it doesn't show in an effective way the impact on the neighborhood. I can say that the train currently runs through our neighborhood. We hear it in the evening, at night, in the morning. This feels like a done deal. It feels very much like the San Francisco PUC and the pipeline project, in which North Fair Oaks bore the brunt of the damage. Our trees were cut down, our fences, buildings, our neighborhood was adversely affected in a way that the city of Menlo Park, the other side of Marsh Road, was not. This sounds very familiar and very similar to that. You're talking about diesel equipment, you're talking about the noise that multiple train trips will make. That will be something that will be very audible to our community, and in addition to the construction, which will be have a tremendous impact on the quality of our life. You mentioned a disparate effect that you don't want, that the policy is to not benefit one city to the detriment of another. This would benefit other communities to the detriment of North Fair Oaks. So it certainly fits your disparate category. I also am very concerned that Facebook is the funder. Facebook, you mentioned Facebook is a stakeholder and a funder. It's hard for me to imagine that.
You have about 30 seconds.
It's hard for me to imagine that they would be an impartial party. And it's safe to say that the Facebook effect on this community has not been positive if you look at the traffic impact.
Thank you so much. Your time is up. Thank you.
In short, I hope this is not a done deal and that this
thank
will
you,
be
ma'am.
Considered.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Isabella, is it Chin or Chen?
Chu.
Isabella Chu.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Hi, okay. Isabella.
I couldn't read that.
You have two lovely minutes. There. It's all right. You could put the mic lower if you like.
shorting.
Yeah, there you go.
No, I just wanted to make a couple comments. One is that I'm thrilled that this is happening. I think it's really time for upgrades in infrastructure. A couple comments. One is the bicycle option. I think it's very important to consider at either end, if we want people taking bicycles and out of their cars, to provide either valet parking or to allow bike cars on whatever, not everyone wants to slog 10 miles in a headwind to work. And then the other comment is that just a plug for sort of a light rail option. I think that that will alleviate a lot of the concerns about noise and heavy machinery and blaring horns and things like that. But I'm just really thrilled about this, and I certainly hope that public transportation and bicycling and walking will be given sort of preferential treatment. But that's just my preference.
Thank you.
Thank you. And we have one more speaker, Barry Ferreira.
Hi, Barry. You have 2 minutes. Thank you.
Yeah. Barry Ferrier, Union City. I spent 10 years on the Citizens Advisory Committee for Alameda County Transportation and almost 10 years on the Dumbarton Rail Policy Advisory Committee. You need to include that committee, and you need to find a way to notify the citizens of the East Bay. I only found out because a notice came to our city staff members that were involved in the past, and our mayor. Back quite a while ago, ABAG's projections for population for 2035 were the nine Bay Area counties were moving from 7 million to 9 million people, and in Alameda County alone, from 1.5 million to 2 million people. And of course, we feel like there's a million people come through us to get here. It feels like that during the day, especially if you have to drive 580 or 680. 880 is now a disaster. The major arterials other than the freeways are now jammed up. So we're feeling the impact really bad. I also have a relative on Bay Road in Menlo Park. He's 80 years old. And if he needs an ambulance, he's got a problem getting it there. So you have major problems on both sides of the bay, but you need to include us on the other side. And the main goal is to take some pressure off us over here. And get some of these businesses to open up alternative offices on our side. We need them around our BART stations. Put the pressure on them. They don't need to drive. They all don't need to drive over here to do the job of the electronics. Also, in
about 30 seconds, sir.
Okay,
thank you.
In the $8 billion 30-year bond issue we had in Alameda County, about $120 million directly and up to $350 million was allocated for what originally was the Dumbarton Rail, but they took the word rail out of the measure so it would pass. And but it is for the Dumbarton corridor, so you need to take advantage of that. And the young lady in the back nodding her head knows well about that. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Barry. All right, so that ends public comment. Anyone else fill out a speaker slip? All right, so we have some questions for the audience.
I think I have two questions from the first and third speaker. Clue me in if I missed any specific questions.
Sure.
In terms of the first comment, I think you were referring to the alternatives that were put forth after the last alternative study, which I believe were two competing commuter rail options. Is that right? Where's our first commenter? To be a little bit more specific, I think you're referencing
Henry.
Yeah, the first question, I believe, was to what degree will study investigate infrastructure using lighter equipment?
Right. But I think you referenced at the very beginning the previous commuter rail alternatives that were put forth, which is?
So at least 10 years ago, maybe.
Okay. Okay.
Quite conveniently up and down the peninsula during the day, and then park them back there.
Yeah, got it. Okay, that makes sense. So certainly, we're going to be looking at previous commuter rail options that were identified around 2011, and similar to what you're talking about, where Caltrain-like trains would run, you know, on the right-of-way and then across the bay. And then we'd, of course, try to obtain some of those regional rail connections, both to ACE and Capital Corridor and then to Union City BART. So that's one option. Yes, we're looking at lighter vehicles in the form of light rail, which is similar to what VTA runs. So certainly that's an option on the table. That would require actually the acquisition of more right-of-way in the East Bay, but we're going to look at it. My understanding is that any alternative that we want to run across the rail bridge will require the rehab of the rail bridge. So even if it's a bike ped, we'll have to rehab the rail bridge. And I also want to mention that a portion of the rail bridge actually burned down in the 90s. So it's not even a complete structure. So any alternative that includes the rail bridge will just have to involve the rehab and, of course, the cost of the rehab.
So we gotta stay with the stay with the questions.
Public comment has ended. So
thank you.
Okay, sorry about that.
Yeah, we gotta make it go.
And then for further questions, I mean, imagine that SamTrans will be here afterwards, so you can ask them further comments or questions.
Thank you so much, everyone.
Okay, I believe the second question related to whether the project's a done deal. I'd like to emphasize it's really not. If you were to ask me what I think is going to be passed forward, I actually really don't know. I think we have some really good options on the table, and I can't tell you at this point in time what's going to proceed forward to the final recommendation. I have no idea. I have some inclinations that something like PRT or GRT may not perform as well as some of these modes that we're a lot more familiar with and that are probably more important for the corridor. But as of now, I can't say. In terms of Facebook, you know, as a partner, they've been really great about being impartial. If they have ideas about what they want to see, they certainly haven't told me. And we're proceeding as if Facebook wasn't our partner. They want to be involved, of course, because they're really close to the right-of-way and they're very interested, I mean, interested enough to provide us funding. But we're being very careful that this is an impartial study. I do not talk to them offline about what their opinions are. I don't really want to know. I want to go forward with our analysis as we would normally. So I just want to emphasize that. We're really trying to be very impartial. Okay?
Well, no, we have some more. We have the noise complaints.
Yes.
No clear signs, noise complaints. We also have the bicycle valet parking and also the Citizens Advisory Committee follow-up. Those are three things that I feel like have to be.
So I'll just say in terms of the noise, we're very aware that certain types of transit would come with noise impacts. Certainly other types of transit would have less noise impacts, and that will factor to some extent in our analysis. Of course, those types of issues would be investigated further in any subsequent environmental document. I don't think there was a specific question about that.
No, just I think just information on moving forward. The type of equipment was mentioned, so the heavy equipment, that makes a lot of noise.
Yep, and that will be factored into our analysis, especially later in our comparative analysis where we're looking at, you know, different transit options that could have different impacts.
And the bicycle valet parking idea, based on the headwinds of a crazy October-autumn day?
Sure, yeah, we're not at that point in our study where we're identifying bike cars. But certainly, we want to be conscious of what makes cycling a little bit easier. And so that will factor into later analyses, certainly.
And I think the last one was the Citizens Advisory Committee. When I asked that question, I think it was perfect timing with this question was asked. Citizens Advisory Committee being included in some of the processing of the framework of what you're going to come up with.
Absolutely. And if I can get your information, I will absolutely send you invites to our next round of meetings, if that works for you.
Through the chair, the last speaker spoke about the lack of outreach. So I don't know, what are you conducting on the other side of the bridge?
In the East Bay community?
Yeah.
Exactly what we're doing on the peninsula.
Because he was from Union City.
Yeah. So every meeting that we have on the peninsula is paired with a meeting in the East Bay because we know it's really difficult to cross that bridge. hence our study. So, you know, at each study milestone, we've got two stakeholder meetings for staff level agencies. We do one meeting on the peninsula, one meeting in the East Bay, and the same goes for our public meetings. One on the peninsula held in the evening, one in the East Bay held in the evening. And I will, I had a thought, now I've just lost it. Notification? Okay, let me give you my card and we'll talk.
All right.
I wanna make sure everyone's notified.
Closing comments, I think, yeah. So we're gonna close this line item. Thank you, Melissa, for your time.
Sure.
And your presentation, and I'm sure you're gonna get a lot of emails, phone calls.
Sure.
And we appreciate you. Thank you.
Yeah, no problem. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, next up we have reports to council. The supervisor's report, Irving Torres, Legislative Aid District 4.
Good evening, council members. My name is Irving Torres. I'm Legislative Aid to Supervisor Warren Slocum, and I'm going to be reporting on his behalf tonight. The first update that I wanted to give to the council members is we had a total of 175 people that attended the fourth annual North Oaks cleanup event, along with council members Dale Miller, Laura Kaplan, Esperanza Vasquez, and then we also had partner organizations that came out. Sequoia High School came out, the North Oaks Youth Initiative, and other community leaders. And so we collected over 6,000 pounds of garbage in North Oaks. And so it was a huge effort. And so thank you, council members, as well as the community members for being part of the fourth annual North Oaks Community Cleanup. Secondly, on June 11th was the third annual North Oaks Bicycle Rodeo, where we had 180 participants. We were able to give out free bike helmets, as well as give away free bikes. And we also had resource booths for any participants that were interested in gathering resources in terms of sustainability or other access to college and so forth. So. A huge thanks to the California Highway Patrol, the Sheriff's Office, Office of Sustainability, especially Rafael and the Siena Youth Center, the Bulldog Riders. They were a huge help, and they were the ones that really made this event possible. So thank you, Rafael, and to the Bulldog Riders. I also want to let the council know the county has worked on adopting, well, creating a new app designed to help dads in San Mateo County. And so the features of this app includes like a playground locator, job posting, parenting tips, and event calendar. And I believe the app is called SMC Dads. So you can go to the mobile app website to download the app. It's for iPhones, it's through the Apple Store and Android Store as well. So I believe it's called the SMC Dads mobile app. So for those of you that are interested. And then finally, this was a request made by the chair in regards to the updates in regards to Flood Park. So as you are aware, there was an April 7th Parks and Recreation Commission meeting that approved the preferred plan and concept and the request for the impact study. So the next steps is the Parks Department is in the process of selecting a consulting firm that will conduct the environmental impact review. And the key focus areas will be potential impact that the plan may have on noise, traffic, and parking. And they anticipate beginning the study in late August. Also, the Parks want to let the council know that the Parks have met with a couple of park neighbors who reside on the Del Norte side of the park to further have dialogue, to hear about their concerns regarding the locations of the soccer field and potential noise and traffic flow. So they have been continuously talking with the neighbors and providing those updates. And that is all that I have to report for tonight. I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Yeah, Irving, can you just tell the council the vote of the Parks Commission from that meeting, if you may.
I don't really have the official numbers of what the vote was.
But it passed.
It passed, yeah.
So just letting you know the recommendation that we gave to the Parks Commission, if I may, through you, Irving. Yeah, that it passed.
Sure. So as I mentioned, on April 7th, the Parks and Recreation Commission approved, so they voted on the preferred plan and concept and request for an impact study.
Thank you so much. Yeah, I just wanted to that our recommendation was heard.
Oh, I did have one more point. So the FAA has actually given approval for alternate flight route. So as you know, there's been concerns about kind of the arrival onto San Carlos Airport. And so there's been kind of talks with the FAA about seeing if there's a possible flight route flying across over the bay. And so I believe more information will be provided, but I believe that the FAA has given a six-month pilot program to test out this new alternate flight route. And basically, it would occur during like sunny and normal conditions. It wouldn't apply if it's cloudy or it's really, I guess, tough weather. And so I will be providing an email to the council in the next couple of days to provide some more information about this.
Through the chair.
Yeah.
Why should we be concerned about that? I'm sorry. You're talking about a flight route out of San Carlos Airport.
So as you recall,
how is that impacting North Fair Oaks?
So as you recall, there was.
I'm sorry, I don't recall. You have to remind me.
So there was. We received phone calls as well as the San Carlos Airport about arrivals to San Carlos Airport about the increase of noise that flights passing over their homes, and so it was causing concerns from the neighborhoods about the noise. And so we've been having some discussions about, you know, ways to mitigate the noise when planes are flying or arriving onto San Carlos Airport. And so between discussions with the FAA, there was a suggestion about seeing if there could be an alternate route, so that way the planes, when arriving to San Carlos Airport, wouldn't fly over the houses or the specific neighborhoods that residents were complaining about.
If I may, through the chair, this involved Surf Air, which had 20. Yeah, okay. It wasn't
so
the regular flights,
Surf Air.
Right?
Okay.
It was 20. Sorry. They had 24 flights arriving every day, okay. and Atherton, North Fair Oaks was seriously impacted by that continual noise. So approximately 85% of those flights will be rerouted out over the bay on a western and then northern approach in rather than over North Fair Oaks and Atherton.
When is this going to be implemented?
It should be
July 5th.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions?
No. Thank you, Irving.
Thank you, Irving.
All right. Deputy County Manager Michael Callaghan.
Thank you very much. Just very quickly, I just wanted to take this opportunity to remind all of you of the zoning work group meeting that is coming up on July 6th. It's a Wednesday night at 6:30 at the Siena Youth Center. It's a great opportunity for everyone to get involved in the zoning, and this will be in regard to the area along El Camino and Fifth Avenue. So we'll have all our planning people there, and we really hope for a great turnout so we get a real cross-section of input on what folks are hoping for and help in the design of that new zoning ordinance.
If I may, through the county manager, please, there will be parking available in our new parking structure, which is a garden joint space. So there's plenty of parking. The gates will be open. So just had to mention, because parking.
Right. We will have parking. But I also want to thank the Siena Center, Sister Christine and Raphael, for the opportunity to have it there. It's really impacting, will impact that neighborhood. So we want to make sure that we do get residents from that neighborhood.
And Mike, can I just specify the area is actually Fifth Avenue and El Camino all the way up to Target?
That's correct.
So it's the phase two of the zoning master plan?
Correct. Okay. Yes, thank you. 6:30. And we'll have flyers that we'll be sending out. Our wonderful North Fair Oaks team will be getting the word out as much as possible. And we will, if you don't have them already, we will get them to all of you. Okay, good. You do have them. Terrific. Yes. Just an update on code compliance and the manager position. We've had the 17 applicants. They closed today, and we'll be vetting those applications, and we expect to be conducting interviews late next week in the hope of picking a new code compliance manager within the next week or two. And of course, we'll introduce him to the council once we do that and get him very familiar with the area down here. And then the last thing I'd like to do is introduce our newest member of the North Fair Oaks outreach team, Maggie Cornejo. As you know, we already have Victor and Jennifer, who are our outstanding members. We have an incredible addition. So Maggie, why don't you come up here? I'm gonna ask you to introduce yourself and tell us a little bit about yourself. Maggie's a new graduate of San Jose State. She can tell you what she majored in and a couple other nice things.
Hi, my name is Maggie Cornejo, and like Mike said, I just graduated from San Jose State with a major in political science and Spanish as well. I grew up in North Fair Oaks for like the first 10 years of my life, so I used to live in 21 Arrowhead Lane, and I was so disconnected, not that I wouldn't visit, but I was just always in San Jose, and now I feel really good of being back and just working, starting to work with the community that was basically my first community. So I'm excited to see what we can do and just to move forward as a team.
Great. I've got to tell you that it was a very, very competitive process, but Maggie really stood out from everyone else with her energy, her spirit, her knowledge of this area, and we're so looking forward to making sure that she's embedded down here and working with the residents, with the other, with our other two North Fair Oaks outreach coordinators.
Welcome back home.
Welcome. Thank you.
So
thank
are you alumni of Garfield?
Yeah, I actually went to Garfield all the way up to fifth grade, and then I moved to Mountain View. Garfield actually offered me, they introduced me to a scholarship, and then I moved to a private school in Mountain View, and then I always had like a really close relationship, and then I came back to Menlo Atherton, and then I went to San Jose State.
Oh, good. Well, welcome.
Thank you.
Yeah.
That is my report. I'm certainly happy to answer any questions you may have.
Through the chair, I had a question about the status of the steering committee working with the ACOM consultants.
Right. We are waiting for some traffic information to come forward. We're doing some traffic studies down here now, and once we do that, we're ready to reconvene that committee and get everyone back focused on Middlefield Road in the hopes of moving that project along very quickly. So we're just waiting for that information. We feel that we should have it within the month, is the last I heard from Public Works. But I'd also like to remind you the council, that work is continuing behind the scenes on the PG&E undergrounding and that whole process. So they're not the project is not stopped by any means. We do have weekly meetings about the overall process and staging, and we will be coming back to this council with a business sustainability plan in the near future. So we're working behind the scenes to keep the ball moving, and we feel that once we get that steering committee back in place, we will move very quickly and bring that back to this council with a plan.
Is there an approximate date for the PG&E or period of time? Is there something actually scheduled?
No, and that seems to be somewhat of a moving target, but what I will do is, I'd like to, I mean, that's a great question.
Year?
Right. I'd like to look into that, and I'll have that information for you the next meeting. That's a good question.
I ask because that is going to happen first.
Correct.
Before everything else. So the way I see it, once that gets going and is on schedule, then things are going to fall into place.
Right.
Right.
Absolutely. And the design of the intersection out here on the railroad tracks is still underway. They're trying to figure out the best way to handle that intersection. So a lot of work behind the scenes is still going on.
Yeah, I have a question. So for the Middlefield, for the work that's going on behind the scenes and the weekly meetings, with the planning. Is there a way to have just a general one sentence update on like a news feed for us to know what's going on? Because we read news feeds all the time, like with decisions that happen in local government, big time government, nationwide government, other governments. It would be great to have like a news feed dedicated to this plan. And I think we have a website, which is bilingual, that would be very beneficial for us to use as a tool to inform our local constituents and our leaders.
Great. Yeah, absolutely. If nothing else, we should be able to email that information out to you, and you can disseminate it as you see fit. But yeah, we need to. We should start doing that on a weekly basis, yeah. And I'll put that on our work plan to at least update you on that. Along Middlefield Road, also, I should update you on the parking lot. So the parking lot, there was an option to by the seller to extend for another 30 days as they try to 1031 their property into another property. They have asked for that extension, and that has been granted. It was in the contract. So they have another 30 days. In the meantime, we are looking at some conceptual designs that we'll bring back to the community for that parking structure. Parking lot. And they're doing some environmental phasing on the property to determine if there's any contaminants or anything else on the property. So work is proceeding on that as expected. And next month I should have a date when we'll take possession of that property and when a demolition should occur on that property, and then the construction should start.
Okay. On that topic, there's a question that came up about what is the association between what's happening on what you just reported and the parking consultant recently hired.
Yeah, good question.
So that was a question. What's the connection? What's going to be the purpose of that? Is it too premature, or what's happening?
So in regard to, let's start with the parking lot itself. The property that we bought. We will be coming back to the community and talking about with them conceptual designs of what it should look like. And this would be a great opportunity for us to really build a beautiful parking lot, something that's very aesthetically pleasing for the area as far as parking lots go. And we'll be talking to the community about what they'd like to see that parking lot consist of in regard to term parking. Would it be metered? Would it be 1 hour parking? Would it be 2 hour parking? Clearly, one thing that we're really, I think, set on is that it won't be overnight parking, because we don't want people storing their vehicles there. We do want turnover parking there. And then we're also looking at the PUC lot very near there. Just a couple blocks away, and we're proceeding on that piece of property also, where we feel that we could fit another 11 or 10 cars. Now, the broader question that you asked about parking on Middlefield Road, we'll look at Middlefield Road holistically, the side streets, the Middlefield Road parking situation itself. Should that and could that be metered parking? Would that create turnover parking without impacting the businesses? Should it be 1 hour parking or 2 hour parking? Should some of the side streets be permanent parking for residents only? It'll look at that holistically. It'll give us the numbers. It'll give us the peak hours of parking, and we'll have a better idea working with the community at the steering committee on what we believe we should go forward with on in regard to parking on a holistic basis for Middlefield Road.
Just to follow up pretty much on that same line of thinking, because these questions came up at the previous session, there was previously a parking work group. There were a lot of people from the community involved. There was a consultant. And I'm just wondering, is there going to be any follow-through or integration with what happened and what came out of that? Because now another consultant is being hired, and nothing really ever happened after the first one. So I would like to know what kind of integration, or that there is going to be something. Curious about that. And also a second piece was on the parking lot, and I know we don't have possession of it yet, so it's not purchased yet, technically. If you're looking at a delay on 1031 exchange investigation. So assuming this all goes through, though, is there a plan for the future to perhaps do more to maximize this space with a parking structure? I know you corrected that, and I know that's expensive, but I also know that, you know, land is expensive. So I'm just curious if that was looked at or if it's being looked at as a potential for the future.
Yeah, let me first start with your first question. And yes, absolutely. Our consultants are looking at that first study, but we believe that first study didn't go far enough. It didn't really look into the neighborhood parking permit process, and it didn't really look at metered parking or the impacts of 1 hour or 2 hour parking as it relates now to a new Middlefield Road where some of the parking will be removed. So we're looking at this with fresh eyes, but also incorporating that last study and specifically looking at some of the neighborhood parking impacts off of Middlefield Road. And again, trying to maximize parking in the area. The second question is something that, yes, absolutely, you're absolutely right. This land anywhere nowadays is very expensive. And we would look to maximize it, but we wanted to start with a parking lot first to see what kind of utilization we'd get out of that. Is it enough parking? We feel that we could create up to 60-65 parking spaces. We'll create some more parking along Middlefield where there's now driveways. Is that enough to satisfy the needs of the commercial community along Middlefield Road? And if not, then we can certainly look at a multitude of things. We could look at a parking structure going up. We could look at residential above that, to low-income housing above that on Middlefield Road. We could look at businesses down below and then some parking structure above it. So there's a multitude of things that we'll look at. The nice thing is, you're absolutely right, we don't own it yet, but I firmly believe that this transaction will go through. Contingencies have been removed, and it's just a matter of time. But we will continue to keep you advised of our progress on that. And yes, looking forward to the future. This council will have some good decisions to make with this property that I'm sure that we'll own.
Yeah. I think one last thing, Mike. We missed you last meeting. That's why we're asking you so many questions. But a really good idea came up in our past meeting. And through the local business sustainability plan that's on our work plan, we were wondering if there's a way to create a groupthink model where policymaker, council, constituents, business owners are all in one room coming up with a strategic plan together, as opposed to you rolling out something and delivering it to us, because we feel that it will have more of a pump to it. What's your take on that?
Yeah, I think there's absolutely an opportunity to do that. I think that what we have right now is a framework, a draft. But I'm the supervisor, and certainly I am a believer in the power of groups that get together, especially community members and stakeholders, those who are vested in really trying to come up with the best possible practice for any type of issue that we're faced. So I think there's an absolute opportunity for that. I do think that we have a pretty good framework, but why not utilize everyone's knowledge and abilities and ideas? We can certainly distribute the draft that we have at some point and get the community together and say, let's just start with this as a basis and then expand upon that. Yeah. And I'm very sorry to have missed the study session. I was in East Palo Alto at another meeting. So.
Yeah. You're a busy man. We appreciate you being here.
No.
But, yeah, it's one of those things where we feel that we can really help build trust to the county with our suggestions and with the local constituents who we see every day.
Absolutely. Makes great sense.
We want to do that.
Makes great sense. I agree wholeheartedly.
Through the chair,
yeah.
I think it goes beyond having a framework. We have some real important documentation already from previous community meetings, previous studies. So I don't know who in your office can, retrieve that very important information. The problem we run into is that we've asked people to participate in many different meetings. Yeah. And give them options and ideas, and they tell us what they think are the issues and what the solutions are. and then it's dropped. I don't want to drop that information that was already, you know, retrieved from the community. All the discussions we had in this room. So I just don't want to lose that. And I don't think we should be starting from scratch. We have some history on that particular topic. And I hope that your office will, you know, get that information. And as Laura had the term, I like the term she used, to integrate it. Mm-hmm. And I just don't want to see it lost. Because in North Fair Oaks, you keep asking people for information, and they give it to you, and they give it to you, and then it comes up to a point where they're not going to give us that again. They're going to get tired of doing that because nothing's been done with it. So I just want to respect that. It's there. It's been done. Let's use it to formulate an actual framework with some meat to it. So that's I just want to put that out there.
No, yeah, that's a point well taken. I mean, we ask so much of the community, and they're giving up their valuable time to come in and give us information. We have captured that, as far as I know. The person that's tasked with putting this together, or at least putting that framework together, has pulled from many resources and many of the past information that's been given to us by the community. And that's Nicholas Calderon, our real property manager. But what we felt with this was that some time has passed, situations have changed, businesses have turned over, and we wanted to really take a fresh look. And as we get closer to the actual redesign of Middlefield Road, and then put that out for the work, we need to build back a schedule of when we go out to the community to start rolling this plan out. But I think it's an excellent idea to involve the community and to incorporate those past ideas, and we'll certainly follow up on that and do that. Yeah.
Let us know how we can help.
Okay. Yeah. And what I might do, I think a good starting place would be to schedule a study session with this council to have our real property manager come in and just talk about, like Linda said, what has been the experience of the past, what information we've gathered in the past, and the framework that he's put together now. Let's start there and then talk about who we think we'd like to have on a steering committee, or should we open it up to the entire community to come in a study session type of situation, give feedback. But we can talk about the framework that you'd like to involve people in.
Yeah. Does anyone recommend that as a future? That's
good.
Recommendation.
Good.
All right. Mm-hmm. Recommendation for one of our next study sessions to be a focus study group on this topic.
Yep.
Thank you, Mike.
Thank you.
All right. Any other questions? All right. Thank you so much for your time, and thank you for being here. You were in traffic, I'm sure, so we appreciate it.
It was traffic. Yeah.
So next we have a council member reports, line item number 7. Any council member reports?
So it's already been reported that the cleanup day was a big success. I wanted to acknowledge Planning Commissioner Manuel Rodriguez for his time.
Yeah, Manuel.
And I wanted to reiterate his comment about, in previous years, well, historically, he brings his own vehicle to help distribute supplies for the cleanup and also pick up the big items around the neighborhood. And so he commented that this year there wasn't a lot of big items because of the C-Click Fix application. So
good.
Kudos to the county for their work there.
Hi, Manuel. I didn't see you back there.
Thank you.
Thank you, Manuel.
Ramirez.
Yeah, Ramirez. You said Rodriguez. Anyway, we know who you are. I just wanted to mention the very heartfelt email that I believe we all got from Mike Mascarick. Could never pronounce his name. Mascarick. Former Commander Highway Patrol sent an email
that he was leaving Highway Patrol, and I thought it was really nice of him to do that. And I told him that I think it made a huge, it took it to the next level when he started getting involved, you know, with the council and doing his reports. It used to be on a monthly basis, and then he went quarterly and all that. The communication was excellent. And so I just wanted to publicly thank him for his time that he spent with the North Fair Oaks Council. And I just wished him well. I forgot where he's headed. He's going somewhere. I'm trying to remember.
He's going PG&E.
Oh, PG&E. Oh, okay. Right, head of their safety, right. Something, safety unit or.
Right.
Yeah. So anyway, just wanted to throw that out. And who, you saw it in the newspaper? Oh. And I'm not sure. So who is the new commander? Has he been?
They have an interim
yet?
For right now.
Oh.
And I believe it's Susie. I can't recall her last name, but
okay.
They're the sheriff's office as well as California Highway Patrol are to report back to the council, I believe, next month. So. Mm.
Okay. Anyway, I just wanted to put that out there.
All right. I just want to say thank you to all the council members and our constituents and all of our families that came out to the community cleanup. Taking a step forward as council members and being there, we really appreciate it. Also, Manuel, appreciate your time, your energy, and your heart. It pounds strongly for this community. Truly appreciate it. And NFO Bike Rodeo, just appreciations to District 4, all of the county of San Mateo, really resourcing our community out here on bicycle safety. About 180 kids got helmets, and Woodside Bike Shop hooked us up with about 10 bikes to raffle off, which was amazing. And aside of that, the county got a ton of swag giveaways, camel packs, helmets, gloves, shirts, and smiles that the youth had on that day was priceless. It was priceless, so. Thank you so much.
So through the chair, also just want to acknowledge the NFO Forward team for their outreach for making kind of both events, the cleanup event and bicycle rodeo, a success. So thank you, NFO Forward.
Yeah, thank you so much to NFO Forward. And also the North Oaks Youth Initiative graduated 28 youth members. Linda and I were at the graduation.
Yeah,
it was very beautiful to see them graduate this year and receive their achievement awards. And we're really planting some strong redwoods here in North Fair Oaks. And I feel that, you know, just we have some representatives here, Emily, Diane. As you can see, they're serving their community on a Thursday night in the summer. And we truly appreciate your servant leadership and your heart. So yeah, congratulations to the 26 others.
Thank you.
Okay.
All right. Adjournment.
Okay. I'll motion to adjourn.
Second?
I'll second that.
All right. Meeting adjourned. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.